When one has a YouTube channel, putting one's life on display to a not insignificant audience, one lives in a fishbowl. Everything I do, every step I take, every move I make, a large number of people are watching me. And YouTube, being what it is, judging me. Which means my decision to part with the dream tour sooner than I thought I would will no doubt be criticized by people who think they speak for me, or speak for four-wheel drive enthusiasts everywhere. But the fact remains that the building of the Aussie Dream Tourer has been a huge learning curve for me personally. People wishing me well have pointed out that I tend to wear my heart on my sleeve. Perhaps I'm over-honest. So here I go again. The Aussie Dream Tourer is not all I hoped it would be. And while it's been a fantastic experience learning from it, working with some wonderful people, and in many ways has fulfilled its purpose, doesn't give me a fizz, a buzz, that unspoken thing that car lovers love about their cars.
The fact that I cannot deny is that I'm not totally happy with the vehicle. And it seems crazy to me now that I am seriously considering, I'm going to replace it. I'm going to replace it. You see, the way I see it is this. I have learned that I don't want to go big. I don't want to drive a vehicle the size of a UNIMOG. Overlanders will say that the UNIMOG is the best overlander you can buy. No, it isn't. It's big. And if you're happy with having to cope with big, then it's going to be better suited to you than small. A vehicle like a UNIMOG is amazing off-road. Its off-road ability far exceeds anything required by the average, and even more than average, overlander. It is required by the extreme overlander. So why would you want to purchase a big vehicle like a MOG? Expensive, complicated, lots of special tools needed for overlanding, unless you are demanding that of the vehicle. Better get a less complicated vehicle, less expensive vehicle, smaller vehicle. Now, what I've learned is that this is obviously nowhere near as big as a UNIMOG, not even as big as an Iveco Daily or Mitsubishi Fuso four-wheel drive. These are four-wheel drive options that we have with trucks with plus minus 5-ton payloads. Here I've got a payload of considerably less than that, and I've learned that I don't want to go big, and I also don't want to go complicated. I actually want to go simple. I want to go back to basics. The camping vehicle, it's as a camper tourer. There were two things that I was trying to achieve by building this tourer. I was trying to maintain off-road ability, and while doing that, increase comfort while sleeping and camping, and also to add an element where I could sit in the vehicle and work inside the vehicle. Have I maintained off-road ability? No. Won't go into details. No. But again, compromise. Was the compromise of off-road ability with the other gains, are they worth it? Have they been worth it? No, and I'll get to that now. A little bit of extra comfort while sleeping. That wasn't a big deal for me because the troopy conversion was very comfortable while sleeping. I would like a little more space, particularly if I'm, you know, sleeping with the two of us. Not that it's cramped, but it's also not roomy. This is roomy. This is far bigger. It's far more comfortable, and principally because the camper lifts like this as opposed to like this. Okay, that's, again, whittling it down to the nuts and bolts. What has made the difference? That has made the difference. In terms of sitting in the vehicle and actually being able to do other work, sitting in the protection out of the weather inside the camper, the Tommy camper is poor. It scores low on being able to sit in it and do other stuff. And I have failed in that. And one of the reasons why I originally wanted, and my idea was thwarted, the quick pitch camper that they made some years ago, they no longer make it, had a totally different design. And that would have solved all my problems. And what I did is I saw the quick pitch camper and I thought, that so ticks those boxes. This one hasn't. This one has not ticked those boxes. So the result is that I've now got a vehicle that, if anything, is worse than the Troopy in terms of sitting in and doing stuff. Worse than the Troopy. I can't really do anything in here. Except for change my clothes. I can't actually do anything. Off-roadability, the quick pitch camper, would it be better than this? No, it would be exactly the same because it would be a similar weight. It might even be heavier. Certainly not a big difference in weight. So the penalty off-road by having this, by having a camper, any camper, on the back of a ute is too high for me. I want a good off-roader. I want to go off-road. I like going off-road. I don't do it nearly enough. I really enjoy off-road driving and I hardly ever do it. Yes, overlanding is my big thing. I live for proper overland travel, wilderness overland travel. I live for it. I don't live for off-road. So I have to build a vehicle that can, that must be able to do both, or have two separate vehicles. I don't want two separate vehicles. I want to build the ultimate vehicle. And so what is the ultimate four-wheel drive? For all of us, each individual, we're all different. What to us is the ultimate four-wheel drive is completely different to our mates, our neighbours. We all are individuals in that regard, and so am I. And I'm lucky enough to be able to be in a position to be able to play with four-wheel drive vehicles and play with overland build. And so I've realized that this vehicle, as it's a great touring machine, make no mistake, it's fabulous as a tourer. As an off-road machine, not really. As a off-road, it's too much of a compromise. It's too much of a compromise. And as I said in my video that I made comparing the troop carrier with the 79 stretch 79, I don't love it. I've not fallen in love with it. So my next build is going to be this. And I've been through the mill. I have sat in my studio and in my workshop and talked to camera, and I don't even know if I'm going to release all the videos or if I have already by the time you've seen this. I don't know. But I'm going to build a troop carrier. I'm going to call it Operation Lightweight, and I'm going to go back to basics. I like having a coffee machine, so I will have an electrical system that is substantial. 300 ampere hour storage capacity is overkill. But because of the weight of lithium, I am happy to go to 200. 200 is plenty, plenty. But because of all my camera batteries charging and the demands of my camera batteries and things, which at the moment I actually have a total of 400 amp hour, I will put in 200. I will keep the interior light. I will And I've got an idea for some semi-remote switching, which, what do I need for remote switching? Me, personally, what do I need for remote switching? Only a few items. So I will do some remote switching, but it's got to be simple, and B, it's got to have a redundancy factor. If it breaks, if the electronics break, I must be able to press a switch. I have to be able to do that. I can't do that with a Red Vision system. Not that it's broken down or given me any hassle at all, not at all. But I have to know that I can get access the water from my water tank in the case of an electronic failure. I have to be able to do that. These fundamental basics that I have to take care of. So by the time you see this video, I would have ordered my next, and I'm ordering the V8 troop carrier. I'd love to have got the new V6 diesel troop carrier, but I'm thinking that's probably only going to come in about, my guess is, at best 18 months' time. That's the replacement of the Toyota 4.5 V8 diesel with I believe it's a 4-litre V6 turbocharged diesel, twin turbocharged diesel. 79, they'll probably only put in a single turbocharger like they did with the 200 Land Cruiser 200, had a very similar engine, but with twin turbochargers, and this has single derated. They'd probably do the same with the 79 series, but I'm not going to wait for that because I don't want to wait. And the other thing is that because of my other project, I need to have the weight capacity to tow, and without the weight capacity to tow, which I am now living with, I cannot tow with this. I'm a GVM. I need to be able to tow, and therefore when I'm building the vehicle must know that once I calculate the ball hitch weight of the trailer, I am still under maximum GVM. And I've got to build, with that in mind, a vehicle that is a very good off-road and a very good tourer camper. And that's my challenge now. It is far more of a challenge than any of these other two vehicles have been for me, because the criteria of weight is so demanding. So thank you for watching and keep following us. Off we go into the wild blue yonder, but I'll probably wrap it a nice color. What color should I wrap it in? This color? It's epic, this color. It's so good. Or should I go back to green? I welcome your comments.
Thank you for watching. If you haven't already, subscribe and click the notifications bell so you don't miss our weekly videos.